In the world of anime, the newest, slickest thing often rules the roost. My Hero Academia. Still, there's something to be said for the old reliables, and the JoJo's Bizarre Adventure manga has looked fabulous for decades, long before its current anime adaptation. Hey everyone, I'm Adrian from Cartoon Hangover, and today we're delving into the strange journeys, weird wanderings, and odd odysseys of the Joestar clan. Rev up your steamroller and attach your severed head to the swollest body you can find. It's time for 107 facts about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure made its manga debut in Shonen Jump in 1987, the very same magazine that's been home to action super franchises like Dragon Ball, Naruto, and One Piece. But before there could be JoJo, there had to be a creator. Hirohiko Araki, born in 1960 in the Japanese city of Sendai, a hometown whose influence on his work we'll discover later. The book's not closed on Araki's birth year, but ask around and you may find people who insist he's actually an immortal vampire and has made appearances in ancient Egypt, feudal Japan, and is even the Mona Lisa. Araki himself is sticking to the 1960s story and attributes his youthful appearance to maintaining an orderly lifestyle and face washing in the Tokyo tap water. It isn't just Araki's clear skin that has people wondering. In 2016, he won a gold medal from the Japan Men's Fashion Association. Vampires are usually snazzy dressers. Araki claims to have grown up with twin younger sisters whose tag team harassment drove him to spend hours in his room poring over his father's collection of art books. The lesson here? Bully your siblings, kids. Then they'll become famous, or vampires, or maybe both. Just kidding, we do not condone bullying, ever. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure wasn't Araki's first work. Before creating the world's foremost manga about classic rock, Italian food, and intergenerational vampire battles, he had to cut his fangs on gambling cowboys in Poker Under Arms and a boy magician who solves crimes in Cool Shock BT. When Araki hit with JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, he really hit. At 120 volumes, it's the 7th longest running manga ever, by volume count, even after switching from a weekly to a monthly publication in 2004. Perhaps the craziest thing is how long it took JoJo's Bizarre Adventure to be adapted into a TV anime, 25 years. Something to think about the next time you need encouragement to keep up your hobby. In those two decades, there definitely were some false starts. An adaptation of Part 3 of the series was released straight to video in the 90s and 2000s to a lukewarm reception, perhaps because the two halves of the story were released out of order. Things got more rough from there. In 2007, a movie adaptation of Part 1 of the manga was released to commemorate the series' 20th anniversary. It was received so poorly that it's never been released on DVD. One challenge of translating JoJo from page to screen is Araki's unpredictable use of color. The manga is in black and white, but promotional images are colored to evoke emotion in the reader, so a character might have natural hair in one image and eye-searing pink in the next. Araki went through false starts of his own on his path to becoming a manga artist. After years of rejection, he traveled to Tokyo in an attempt to make things happen. But when he reached the offices of the publisher, he was so intimidated by the size of the building that he instead went next door to a smaller office, Shueisha, publisher of Shonen Jump. Araki's work was harshly criticized, but he cleaned up the pages for an upcoming competition and received an honorable mention that set his career in motion. From those humble beginnings, Araki went on to create an expansive world of JoJo media that includes video games, spin-off novels and manga, and a live-action movie recently released in Japan. The JoJo train doesn't stop there. The series inspired merchandise ranging from the mundane, which are art books and figurines, to the bizarre, including a moisturizing face mask for days when Tokyo tap water isn't enough. We've established the source of Araki's longevity, great skincare, but JoJo's lifespan is its own phenomenon. One thing that made the series unique early on was Araki's decision to kill off his first protagonist, something unheard of in the world of shonen manga at the time. Those of you that are new to the series might be asking, but what the heck is a JoJo? Well, the protagonist of each part has two Joes in their name. Joseph Joestar, obvious. Jotaro Kujo, we can work with that. Josuke Higashikata, it's complicated kanji stuff. Try not to stress about it. The very first JoJo, Jonathan Joestar, got his name from Jonathan's, a restaurant where Araki met his editor while developing the series. But where did the second Joe come from? Apparently Araki liked the sound of alliteration in Steven Spielberg's name and decided to invent a J name for Jonathan. Sometimes it's that simple. Araki had to push to get Jonathan Joestar onto the page, and not because Shonen Jump resisted a hero named after a diner. It was actually considered taboo in the industry at the time for a shonen comic to have a non-Japanese protagonist. The JoJo's got their name from Araki's coffee purveyor of choice, but arch-nemesis Dio Brando is the first in the long line of music references. His name is a combination of Ronnie James Dio's name from the heavy metal band Dio, and also the Italian word for God, which is Dio, along with actor Marlon Brando's name. Due to copyright issues, the names would sometimes change in English subtitles, such as Dio becoming D. Dio in the English text. JoJo was first inspired by the muscle-bound movie stars of the 80s, like Stallone and Schwarzenegger. Araki conceived of Jonathan and Dio as embodiments of pure good and pure evil, to represent opposite sides of what the strongest man in the world might go after, power and immortality on one hand, and justice on the other. But looking back, Araki feels that he may have made Jonathan too pure. If he were going to rewrite Part 1, he would give the first JoJo a more flawed, realistic personality. On the other hand, Dio is precisely as evil and charismatic as he's supposed to be. Araki drew inspiration for the character from FBI profiling of serial killers, which was was a hot topic as he was writing part one. While Jonathan and Dio's muscles came from the movies, the dramatic poses that became Araki's trademark go back centuries further to the Renaissance sculpture that he saw on a trip to Italy. Jonathan Joestar is voiced in English and with an English accent by the prolific Johnny Yong Bosch, who has shown in hero experience to spare from his time as Bleach's Ichigo Kurosaki. Dio, on the other hand, is voiced by Patrick Seitz, who voiced the most famous vampire of all, Dracula, in several Castlevania games. Of course, again, if you know anime, you should know who Patrick Seitz is, as he's been in One Piece, Bleach, and Fairy Tail. Dio's Japanese voice, meanwhile, comes from Takehito Koyasu, who plays another franchise-spanning baddie as the Japanese voice of Batman nemesis the Joker in both Lego Batman and Suicide Squad. Joestar ally Robert Speedwagon is another referential name, this time to power ballad makers REO Speedwagon. Given the band's penchant for decidedly un-JoJo romantic ballads, we're guessing Araki chose this one for the sound more than for symbolism. The ripple fighting technique that Jonathan Joestar learns and uses against Dio was inspired by the supernatural powers that Araki saw in the karate manga in his childhood. William Zeppeli, who teaches Jonathan the ripple, was named after Led Zeppelin, a decision that Araki sometimes questions looking back, because he used up the name of a group he holds in such high esteem so early on. Of course, its elaborate battles are just as famous as JoJo's supernatural powers, like Jonathan's chain neck deathmatch with Tarkus. Araki was inspired by his 70s manga, Mitsuteru Yokoyama's Babel 2, whose hero was thrust into fights with complicated rules. Speaking of Tarkus, Araki named the Zombie Knight after an album from English prog rockers Emerson, Lake, and Palmer. Years later, From Software paid homage to JoJo and Dark Souls with an undead knight of its own, Black Iron Tarkus. And that, kids, is Referenception, a reference within a reference. The iconic credits theme song from parts 1 and 2, that spawned an entire meme around the show's to-be-continued cliffhangers, is called Roundabout from 70s rock group Yes, one of Araki's favorites in his youth. Speaking of mimetic influence, Araki's signature sound effect, a menacing rumble indicated by the Japanese character Go, was inspired by the ominous synthesizer sounds of 80s horror movies. Looking back, Araki views his growth as an artist during part 1 of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure as mirroring Jonathan's journey. In the same way that Jonathan grows through his dealings with Dio, Araki grows through the challenges of drawing a weekly manga, which helped Araki define his own art. Araki planned for his series to move from one protagonist to the next from the very beginning, something no one else was doing in manga at the time. He was inspired by the multi-generational narrative of the historical miniseries Roots. The familial connection between characters is important to Araki, who said he needs those connections to help himself understand his new cast in each successive era of the series. Araki gave Joseph an extra strong resemblance to Jonathan to maintain a sense of continuity. Presumably, fans got what was going on well enough by part 3, so the JoJo's grew more diverse from there. On the flip side, the similarity between the characters drove Araki to push their personalities as far apart as he could, explaining how pure, noble Jonathan could have a grandson as wild as Joseph. As wild as Joseph is, he's actually a more cerebral fighter than his grandfather. Araki wanted to shift the story away from the part 1 punch parties and toward the strategical showdowns that would become his signature. JoJo's ever-shifting focus also extends to its storytelling. Araki always tried to change up his writing, like modeling different sections after RPG-style adventures, murder mysteries, or cross-country races. Still, Araki would argue that all of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure is united by a single theme. It's a work that celebrates humanity. This rings true when you consider the trademark of human ingenuity that his heroes have to use to stop increasingly elaborate powers he gives their enemies. In part 2, Araki wanted to tell the story where Dio came back from the dead, but he felt it would be more impactful to have time pass in the comics instead of jumping straight to the resurrection. Luckily for readers, Joseph's battle with the Pillar Men wound up being less filler and more thriller. Those Pillar Men, by the way, are a 1-2-3 punch of music nods, and they see Araki branching out from classic rock as AC Lightning Bolt DC and the Cars are joined by George Michael's Wham! Wake me up before you JoJo. Sorry. And as a side note, I definitely know it's pronounced AC/DC. It's just the script says Lightning Bolt, so I have to say it. Rudolf von Stroheim, the cyborg Nazi that Joseph is forced to ally with to defeat the musical Aztec trio, gave his signature flat-top hairstyle to none other than Guile, of Street Fighter fame, a character who actually combines multiple JoJo nods. The Pillar Men, meanwhile, combine elements of Roman sculpture, the Great Sphinx of Giza, and Japanese Buddhist guardian statues called Neo. Of course, there's actually a fourth Pillar Man, Santana, who's locked up in a vault and forgotten, another victim of Araki's forgetfulness, which has become a meme unto itself in the JoJo fandom. Fans wonder if Araki also forgot another antagonist, the godlike villain Kars, but the writer has assured fans that the character will never return. Whatever you say, Araki. There's a lot of references to Araki's older work, but one similarity exists between Kars' boneblade technique and a similar ability in Araki's last work, Bao the Visitor. Both include characters that can morph bone and flesh into weapons. Before he was a problem child of the Joestar clan, Joseph's English voice actor, Benjamin Disney, Siskin was 2/5 of the prepubescent crime-fighting squad on Codename Kids Next Door, number 1 and number 2. If you're wondering why Caesar Cipelli is so antagonistic towards Joseph, perhaps it's because his English voice actor, Bryce Papenbrook, isn't used to playing second fiddle. He's used to playing leading roles like Attack on Titan's Eren Yeager and Sword Art Online's Kirito. While we're talking leading roles, Japanese Joseph Tomokazu Sugita has been Haruhi Suzumiya's Kyon, as well as leading man Gintoki in the long-running comedy hit Gintama. But enough of these youngsters, Kazuhiko Inoue lends his voice to the lead Pillar Man and Perfect Life Form Cars, on top of a run as Naruto favorite Kakashi and a long-running career in dubbing American classics. For Lisa Lisa, who trains Joseph in the art of the ripple, Araki drew on the experience of having an older female tutor in school, though he's quick to say that she was nowhere near as sadistic as Lisa Lisa. As luck would have it, taking a chance on writing a female combatant with Lisa Lisa paid off, as Araki realized that supernatural fighting techniques meant he could explore any kind of appearance he wanted for his characters. Joseph's other co-rippler, Caesar Cipelli, was created because Araki regretted not having an opportunity to portray any sort of friendship between the rival leads of Part 1. Dio just never hit it off with Jonathan, what with the whole killing his dog, kissing his girlfriend, and murdering his father thing. It was I, Dio. Lucky for Joseph, Araki didn't commit to killing off every JoJo when their time in the limelight was done, though it seems like he tried. Over the course of his time in the series, Joseph survives 4 plane crashes. Of course, 2 of those crashes are in Part 3, where Joseph is 50 years old and, well, a year or two wiser. Araki knew it would be important to make sure he didn't upstage the new JoJo, and he'd need someone to guide the new cast. Stands, the power introduced in Part 3 that have defined JoJo ever since, weren't easy for Araki to sell to his editors. It took a long time for him to be able to explain what he wanted to do, including several vigorous and confusing bouts of pantomime, but he stuck with it because he recognized just how deep a source of material they could be. Jotaro, the third JoJo and one of the most popular, was conceived as Japanese from Araki's earliest brainstorming. He envisioned JoJo having 3 parts, ending with a final battle in Japan. Obviously, he underestimated how many ideas he had for Stands. While Jonathan and Dio were loosely based on the muscular movie stars, Jotaro is one of the only JoJo characters to have his personality explicitly modeled on another person, Clint Eastwood. Araki sees Eastwood as the ultimate hero who does what he thinks is right without expecting praise or rewards. Jotaro is voiced in the dub by Matthew Mercer, voice of Attack on Titan's Levi and Overwatch's Jesse McCree. And now you know why Dio is so focused on stopping time. He doesn't want the clock to strike high noon. It's so funny. I'll see myself out. Jotaro's Japanese voice is another member of the Survey Corps. Daisuke Ono gives a disarming performance as Commander Irwin. He's also Sebastian of Black Butler fame. Araki views Jotaro's design as the quintessential version of what he aims for when creating characters. A combination of the bizarre and the realistic. Like a muscular high schooler in uniform traveling through the desert. Kakyoin, meanwhile, was designed to contrast with Jotaro as a slender, sensitive member of the group. Araki created a contrast between the two by having them wear the same style of school jacket in different ways. One open, one closed. Remember the weirdness about how one of the JoJos isn't a JoJo because of the kanji? What if we told you Noriaki Kakyoin wasn't Noriaki at all? It turns out Kakyoin's first name can be misinterpreted as Noriaki when Araki intended it to be read as Tenmei. Araki did make it Tenmei in one place, as an Easter egg that appears in the guestbook of the hotel run by the evil Enya, as opposed to the good Enya, who sang the one song from The Lord of the Rings. The name Kakyoin, meanwhile, comes from the neighborhood of Araki's home city of Sendai, and you best believe he wasn't going to let that one get misinterpreted. Kakyoin's stand, Hydrophant Green, was devised in part to give the characters and audience an introduction to the difference between short and long range stands. Araki forgetfulness bonus, Hierophant Green has crazy puppet powers that it uses once and never again. While Kakyoin's stand was meant to contrast with Jotaro's, Jean-Pierre Polnareff has a personality that was meant to make him stand out. He's the loudmouth, the peeping Tom, and the comic relief of the group, and thus the target for many of Part 3's toilet mishaps. Polnareff was actually the original model for Street Fighter's Guile, until an artist flattened his hair into the Stroheim cut as a joke, and the team ran with it. That's why Guile wound up with a name that nods to Polnareff's nemesis, Jay Guile. Wait a second. Who's Jay Guile? It turns out, the volume of musically named characters in the series turned into an enormous copyright snafu, and so official English versions of the anime give several characters alternate names, including Jay Guile, whose official English name is Centerfold, after the Jay Guile's band's hit song. When we first meet Jay Centerfold, he's paired up with fellow enemy Hall Horse, who gives us a taste of the cowboy flavor from Araki's very first manga. Araki actually considered the possibility of having Hall Horse switch sides, before deciding that that would have unbalanced the group. Voice actor side note, way back in 1999, 1993, Whole Horse was played by Roger Jackson. Jackson also voiced a certain hyper-intelligent cartoon ape, Mojo Jojo. That makes him the only Jojo to be Jojo without being Jojo and Jojo. You know, no? The party does get an extra member, though it's a dog instead of a horse. Araki knew he wanted an animal stand user and considered cats and dogs, but it seemed like a cat would end up betraying the group. So Iggy, the Boston Terrier, was born. One oddball detail of Iggy's stand, the Fool, that's never fully explained is the wheels in place of its hind legs. Shonen Jump had a sponsorship deal with an F1 team going at the time, and Araki just thought it would be fun to throw in some race car wheels on a stand. Araki wound up liking Iggy so much that he considered getting a terrier for himself, but realized he couldn't care for a dog on a manga artist's schedule. It's for the best. We don't need vampire dogs running around. On the topic of whims that Araki has and hasn't followed, Muhammad Avdal, wielder of fire, hater of Dio, was killed off because, as Araki explains, he didn't want the readers to get bored. No comment from Avdal on how he felt about that, though. A lot of people on stands in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure are named after songs and singers, but occasionally a smaller reference is thrown in. Avdal's ultimate technique, Crossfire Hurricane, is a Rolling Stones lyric from their song Jumpin' Jack Flash. Of course, Avdal comes back to life later in the story. How'd that pan out? Well, we go now to Araki for a direct quote. He states, "Since I killed Avdal once, I probably should have made him more important to the story." And there it is. Araki did learn another lesson from Avdal. He pretty much made fire off limits for himself as a stand power, because he found that trying to come up with interesting uses for Avdol's Magician's Red was difficult. It doesn't help that he also struggled to draw the bird-headed stand. For someone who claims to not be a vampire, Araki's really thought it through. He made sure to show Dio marveling at how technology had changed while he slept, and when interviewed, he said, "I think being a vampire would be fun as long as you could stay healthy." Speaking of staying healthy, when it came time to create the final battle of Part 3, Araki found himself in a precarious situation, as his editor was in the hospital. Araki had to push forward and design Dio's stand, The World, all on his own. Dio's time-stopping ability was so overwhelming that even as he was writing the final battle, there were times that he didn't know how Jotaro could possibly win. Spoiler alert, Jotaro wins and saves Joseph's life. To ensure Dio hasn't vampired up his grandfather, Jotaro gives Joseph an impromptu quiz on pointless crap that drew the attention of one of the subjects, Weird Al. Of course, if Weird Al exists in the JoJo-verse, that raises some questions about Led Zeppelin and the Rolling Stones. The Muscle Man had a good run, but by Part 4, they were going out of style, and Araki's own tastes were shifting towards something more grounded in the real world, in terms of design. The powers only get weirder, but that's why Part 4's Josuke is so much smaller than Jotaro. Araki pegs the change between the early and later JoJo's as a shift away from the more mythical point of view. Similarly, Dio and the Pillar Men were frequently shirtless to evoke the mythological subjects of Italian sculpture, but as the world of the story became more mundane, he set them and their bare chests aside. JoJo's drifted so far stylistically that Araki admits that he struggles to draw older characters in his newer style, with a shirt or not. Part 4 was born from several sources, but one surprising source of inspiration was the sheer number of unused stand ideas left from Part 3. Araki began to wonder what it might be like if an entire town was populated with the lurking threats he'd devised. At the same time, there'd been a number of high-profile serial killings in the Japanese media, and the idea of a killer on the loose in a small town and the possibility that it could be someone you saw on the street was an atmosphere Araki wanted to explore. Araki created Morio as an analog for his hometown of Sendai, drawing on the feeling of alienation while growing up there during a boom in construction that brought a wave of unfamiliar faces into town. His hometown was an important enough influence that Araki named the main character after a local landmark. Josuke's friend, Koichi Hirose, gets his family name from the Hirose River that runs through Sendai. Of course, longtime fans of the series might not know Morio as Morio at all. When official English versions of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure were almost non-existent, one of the only English translations of Part 4 in wide circulation was an infamous attempt by a Chinese high schooler, which, among other meme-worthy lines, features a misreading of the characters for Morio as Duwang. Part 4 might be Araki's favorite part of all. In interviews, he expressed a wish to revisit Morio and Josuke, even saying that he considered Part 4 unfinished in some ways. People who meet Araki often expect him to resemble Rohan Kishibe, the eccentric and narcissistic manga artist he introduced in Part 4, but he struggles to live up to their expectations. One Rohan behavior that Araki very specifically insists he does not engage in is the habit of licking dead bugs he finds on the floor. Of course, one point where Rohan and the real Araki intersect is in Araki's love for drawing peeling skin, which is imagery that comes up anytime Rohan uses his stand, Heaven's Door. Araki insists that it's not because of the grossness, but because he loves the mental exercise of visualizing and drawing bodies doing impossible things. Rohan is a recurring character in Part 4, and even has a life of his own outside of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure in a series of one-shot comics, including official promotional comics created in collaboration with Gucci and the Louvre in Paris. While Araki insists that he's unlike Rohan, he does bashfully admit to a certain admiration for Part 4 villain Yoshikage Kira, because even though he was a depraved serial murderer, he was dedicated and always gave it his best effort. That's certainly one way of looking at it, Araki. If we've learned anything, it's that Araki places precious little trust in his heroes. Much like Dio, Araki was sometimes afraid that he had made Kira's stand, Killer Queen, too powerful and struggled to write the character because of it. Kira's voice actor, Toshiyuki Morikawa, is no stranger to villains who inspire some surprisingly enthusiastic fans. And the reason why? He's also voiced Sephiroth in a range of Final Fantasy VII spin-offs. Meanwhile, artist and buglicker Rohan is voiced by Takahiro Sakurai, who has some history with Morikawa. He's the voice of Cloud Strife and responsible for several of Sephiroth's deaths over the years. And we'd be remiss not to mention that he's the Japanese voice of Twilight heartthrob Edward Cullen. Fans who've discovered JoJo's Bizarre Adventure through the dub have plenty to be excited for when Part 4 rolls around. When Araki last gave his personal rankings of his favorite characters in all of JoJo, he ranked Josuke and Kira in 1st and 2nd. In the end, Araki actually feels happy that the adaptation of his works took as long as it did. In a sense, it means more to have created something that was loved by audiences for years and finally adapted than to simply have your work animated quickly in the hope of capturing its flash of popularity. Once again, I'm Adrian, and thanks for watching 107 Facts About JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Who's your favorite JoJo? Did we miss anything? Comment below and let us know. Don't forget to click that bell icon to become part of the notification squad. And subscribe to Cartoon Hangover. Oh, and one last thing. Thank you for sharing your Cartoon Hangover with us.